الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما مزيدا إلى يوم الدين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته، وطبتم وطاب سعيكم ومشاكم وتبوأتم جميعا من الجنة منزلا، وأسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يبارك فيكم ويزيدكم علما ونورا. My dear respected brothers and sisters, I welcome you and I greet you with the greeting of Islam. So assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Firstly, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity that we meet in the one of the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we remember and we study amongst us. And as it came in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he encompasses us with his tranquility and with the rahmah and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he remembers us and mentions us in a gathering with him. And secondly, we thank the committee of the masjid for allowing and providing us the ability to uphold and set up, alhamdulillah, this beautiful lecture. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who benefit from it. And also we thank of those who organize and help set up and organize this lecture. And also finally, we thank you for attending, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us and you from those who benefit to the speech. And also we thank our guest speaker, and alhamdulillah, he's not a guest anymore. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him and to reward him and to increase him in knowledge for his efforts that he has been doing. And alhamdulillah, our ustad, Shaykh Al-Rahman Hassan, is from those who are known to us, alhamdulillah. So we won't bore you with any of our speech, and we hand over the mic to him and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to aid him to what is good.
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل واشهد ان سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى اله واصحابه والتابعين لهم باحسان الى يوم الدين اما بعد. I apologize firstly for coming late. I wanted to be here for 12:30 sharp and to start my lecture. So I first of all apologize to have to make you all wait for 40 minutes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all for your patience. And the teacher should set an example, or the person who is the speaker should set an example for those who he is preaching to. And our religion teaches us the importance of time and making sure things are done according to the promised time. So I do sincerely, honestly apologize. I hope that you all accept that apology from me. And I also apologize to the masjid for having to delay half an hour or 40 minutes. My beloved brothers and sisters, the biography of Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, the reason why I specifically chose it and I wanted to speak about it is because Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab's biography is a practical way for us to know what will take us out of our hardship. Many people will say to you, you need to do this, you need to study this, you need to take these practical steps, and inshallah ta'ala, this is the salvation and the solution. But you might think to yourself, this is a theoretical way of looking at it. Shaykh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah ta'ala, his biography is considered tu'addu mithalan hayyan. It's an actual practical example of how we can leave our hardship and our problems. And the way that we can move forward as a nation. So that's why I think we need to study his life. So the way I'm going to do it is I'm going to divide the lecture into two. The first one is talk about the author, talk about the Imam, and explain, allow you to understand who Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab is. And the second part, inshaAllah ta'ala, is durus and ibar, signs and lessons that we can take from his life. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he was born in the Arabian Peninsula, Jaziratul Arab. So let's take a bit about, before the Shaykh came, how was the Arabian Peninsula like? What kind of place was he? He was born when the year was 1115 Hijriya. That's when the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala was born. And at that particular time, the Arabian Peninsula that the Shaykh rahimahullah came from, many of the ulama have spoken about it. And they've allowed us to know that, for instance, Hussein ibn Ghannam al-Ihsari rahimahullah, he's a very famous historian who was actually with the Shaykh. You know, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, when he was traveling, he actually requested from Hussein ibn Ghannam al-Ihsari, he said to him, write the biography of the history that's taking place that I'm with you right now. Write it, document it. And that was a very smart, a very clever mindset of the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala. Because he knew there's going to come a time when people are going to lie about his biography and accuse him of that which he did, accuse him of things that he did which he didn't do. Also, from the scholars that spoke about his life is Al-Imam Muhammad Amir al-San'ali. We spoke about not the life of Muhammad al-Jahab, but he talked about the Jazeera to Arab and how it was like, the shirk and etc. that spread in there. Also, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, the scholar that spoke about it, is Hussein al-Nu'mi rahimahullah. He's from the ulama of Yemen. He also even spoke about the spreading of shirk and misguidance in the Arabian Peninsula before the Shaykh rahimahullah came. So many scholars from different places of the world, they all spoke about it. That this place, Saudi Arabia, which is known as now Saudi Arabia, and not only that, all the neighboring countries like Kuwait, Dubai, Qatar, and Bahrain, and all of this, this is Jazeera to Arab. It was very, very, very prominent with shirk and dalalat, misguidance. And as you all know, the Dawla Uthmaniyya wasn't governing over the Arabian Peninsula. But because the Dawla Uthmaniyya were not giving too much importance to Tawheed, especially at its last stages, shirk was actually spreading, it was on the rise. So it was creeping into the Muslim land. The shirk was coming in and it was growing. The Shaykh rahimahullah, the place he was born in, Uyayna, in which the Shaykh was born in, it had 17 different idols that were worshipped. That the people were actually worshipping besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the place he was born, rahimahullah. And from one of the famous place that people would come to worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was the Qubba of Zayd ibn al-Khattab, which was in Jubayrah. People would go there and they would worship this Qubba, which is a dome, a shrine. They would go there and they would worship Zayd ibn al-Khattab. They built his grave, big shrine. There was also many other kebabs that were made. There was one in Manfuha. There was even one called Fahl al-Fuhul. They called it Fahl al-Fuhul. And this one, women would come who couldn't have children. And they would come to the grave and they would say, Ya Fahl al-Fuhul, Uridu Zawjan Qabl al-Hawl. I want to have a child before the yearly cycle. So they were calling onto besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dir'iyya, which is where the Shaykh is going to go to later, inshaAllah ta'ala. There was also a place where there were many idols. There was a maqam called Taj al-A'ma. There was another one called Kahf al-Amira. There was also Shi'b al-Ghubayra. All of these were shrines that were placed in the Arabian Peninsula. Very famous. So the Arabs at that time, before the Shaykh's coming, they lived Fatrat al-Mudrima. It was a very darkened time where what the Prophet ﷺ fought against, and what our Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, 5 days before he died, what did he say? لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الْيَهُودَ وَالنَّصَارَى اتَّخَذُوا قُبُورَ أَنْبِيَاهِمْ مَسَاجِدٍ. May Allah's curse be upon the Christians and the Jews. They have taken the graves of their prophets and their righteous ones. They took it as what? They took it as masajid, meaning places of worship. The Prophet's cursing this. He doesn't like this action عليه الصلاة والسلام. The thing that he was warning against had actually spread in the land of the Shaykh. The Shaykh, his name is Muhammad Ibn Abd al-Wahhab, Ibn Sulaiman, Ibn Ali, Al-Tamimi, Al-Hanbali, Al-Najdi. Many have spoken about his biography. The two best books I can tell you guys to look at is a kitab called Tariq al-Najd. And it's written by Hussein ibn Ghannam al-Hasai. And also another kitab called, written by Uthman ibn Bishr. It's called تاريخ المجد. When it talks about the scholars of, so it's called Uthman al-Majd, and it's written by Uthman ibn Bishr, رحمه الله تعالى. Also, the Kitab al-Durr al-Sanniya fi Ajubati al-Najdiya, which is actually a compilation of the Shaykh's works and his speeches, you will also find that he mentions the waqa'i and the events that took place. So the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, many have spoken about it. Even the very famous Egyptian historian Al-Jabarti had also even spoke about the biography and the da'wah of the Shaykh rahimahullah. Shaykh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab was born when the year was 1115. And he was born in a place called Uyayna. And it's a place now not far, or it's actually part of Riyadh now, it's actually entered into Riyadh. 15-20 minutes drive from the capital Riyadh. The Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, his father was a judge in Uyayna. His father was a judge, Abdul Wahab. And his granddad, whose name was Sulaiman, was a mufti diyar in Najdiya. He was the mufti of Najd. And you guys know Mansur al-Buhuti, right? The great Hanbali scholar. Sulaiman, who is the grandfather of Muhammad Abdul Wahab, and Mansur al-Buhuti were best friends. So they were very, very close in terms of relationship. Rahimahullah. The Shaykh, it was said about him, the Shaykh rahimahullah, as a child, it became very clear that he was a smart, sharp-minded individual from a very young age. He had alamatul najabat wa dhaka. He was sharp-minded, he was smart, and he was very fast in his memory. And the Shaykh rahimahullah, he gave a lot of time to the works of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and the works of Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah rahimahullah. The Shaykh rahimahullah, Allah opened for him many sciences, the Arabic language, hadith, and etc. And he gave a lot of time to tafsir and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he realized when studying the Quran and the sunnah that many of the people are in opposition to the kitab and the sunnah. So what it happened was, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala made himself focus highly on the foundations and the principles that the people were leaving. And that was Tawheedullah wa ifraduhu bil ibadah. Worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and not associating partners with him. The Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he was one who was revising these masail and these topics. And he used to study them with his father. His father was a person who was upon the correct aqidah and the correct tawheed. The only difference was that his father wasn't as strong and as courageous as Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab was. Rahimahullah ta'ala. The Shaykh rahimahullah, love of knowledge, he traveled. He didn't just stay in where he was born, Uyayna. The Shaykh traveled. And he traveled to many places. He traveled outside his country. He went to Ihsa. He even went to Iraq. The Shaykh went to Mecca. He went to Medina, and he benefited from the greatest scholars of that time. And two are from the most prominent scholars of his. Two are from the greatest imams that he benefited from. The first one is Muhammad Hayat Sindhi, rahimahullah, the great Indian scholar. Muhaddith, he's from the Kibar al-Muhaddithin. And the second one is Sheikh Abdullah ibn Ibrahim ibn Husayn al-Najdi, who he took from in Medina. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he traveled to Basra, part of Iraq. And that's where the Shaykh rahimahullah, at the age of 25, he authored his book that we studied today, Kitab al-Tawheed. And it was only 25 years of age when he had actually authored Kitab al-Tawheed. And the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, when they saw his brain and his thinking, they actually offered him lessons to teach. The problem with it, with that time, was the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala was threatened by the people because of his da'wah and that which he was calling to. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he ran away from Basra. And he made his way to Ihsa, to back to the Arabian Peninsula. He met, whilst he was there, he stayed with Muhammad ibn Fayruz. This individual, Muhammad ibn Fayruz, the Shaykh benefited from him a lot. And he took from him, he found with him many books of Ibn Taymiyyah that he didn't previously see. So the Shaykh gathered those books from him, he read those books from them. And you have to realize, we have publications, so we publish a book, we print it. But at that time, if a person had a book, you had to rewrite that whole book from them. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he would write those books from Muhammad ibn Fayruz. But this Muhammad ibn Fayruz, later when Muhammad Abdullah's da'wah became strong and he became tough, he became min aladhi a'da'i da'wah. It was from the greatest enemies that the Shaykh rahimahullah had. So the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, every person who calls the people to Tawheed and Sunnah, fights against shirk and bid'ah, he is bound to be tested and he is bound to be put through trials and tribulations. So the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, when the year was 1139 Hijriya, he came back to Uyayna and he found rahimahullah that his father had a conflict. His father had a conflict with the leader of Uyayna. His father had a conflict with the leader of Uyayna, and that his father at that particular time left Uyayna and he went to a place called Huraymila. Huraymila was a place where the father of Muhammad Abdu'l-Hab was. So Muhammad Abdu'l-Hab didn't go to Uyayna, he stayed with his father in Huraymila. And this was the year 1140 Hijriya. So the Shaykh stayed there, busying himself with the knowledge, teaching people, writing letters, authoring books, sending those books. This is what he busied himself with. He used to write to the ulama of that time and the people around the outskirts of the city. He would also even write to the neighboring lands. He would author books, things for his students. He was busy fully with teaching and studying. And he always made sure that whatever he said, it was based upon that which he got from the Quran and that which he got from the Sunnah and that which he got from the Athar al-Salaf. And that is clear in his works. Every time he says a statement, he follows it up by saying, وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى. And the evidence for my statement, my view is this. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'a. And the Shaykh rahimahullah used to give a lot of importance to these textual evidences of the Salaf. Rahimahullah. And walidhalika, any discussions that he went into with his opponents and he discussed with them, he was always able to silence them because of the evidence that he brought forward. And the adillah, and how fast that he had it with him. As I said before, his memory was very sharp. Then his father died when the year was 1153. And when your father dies, there's that vacuum and there's that space that's open for you. So it was a bit hard for the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala. The people started to harm him in Huraymila now. And they weren't respecting him. And the Shaykh stood up, regardless of what the situation was. He stood up to call to the good and to prohibit the evil. Anything which he saw, whether it be shirk, whether it be bid'ah, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he would call to the opposite of it. He would call to the tawheed and he would call to the sunnah. And he would warn against bid'ah and he would warn against shirk. Rahimahullah ta'ala. After the Shaykh rahimahullah, he went to a place called Uyayna. Does anyone know what Uyayna is? No, does anyone know what Uyayna is? Did I mention Uyayna? Does anyone remember what Uyayna is? Anything other than that I said about Uyayna? No, other than that? He was born there, Jazakallah khairan. It was where the author, rahimahullah, he was born. But this time, when his father died, he left Uyayna, he went back to where? Uyayna, this is his place of birth. And Uyayna, the man who was in charge, was called Uthman ibn Mu'ammar. Uthman ibn Mu'ammar really loved the Shaykh. He really loved the Shaykh and he had so much love for the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala. So he told the Shaykh, if you're being harmed in Huraymila, come to me in Uyayna, your place of birth, and inshallah ta'ala you'll be taken care of. So the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he came to Uyayna and was taken very good care by Uthman ibn Nasir ibn Mu'ammar. And he really loved the Shaykh. And with the support and the effort of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and Uthman ibn Nasir ibn Mu'ammar, their joint effort, they were able to spread knowledge, they were able to spread the sunnah, and they were able to fight against shirk and bid'ah. Then when the Shaykh rahimahullah saw that the proof was established on the people, and that knowledge spread, and that ignorance has now been removed from the people, with the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah's favor, and of course after that with the effort of the Shaykh himself as well, The Shaykh, what did he do? He now said, let's not just keep our message just theoretical. We spread the Tawheed, we call to Tawheed, we mention the harms of shirk. Uthman, how about if we now take on ourselves, since you're the leader of the tribe, we go out and we destroy these idols and these graves and we flatten them and we bring it back to how the Sunnah was. So Uthman ibn Muammar gave Muhammad Abdul Wahhab the thumbs up. So Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, he went. Uyayna alone, how many trees did we say and how many idols were there that people worshipping? 17. The Shaykh Rahimahullah, he destroyed each and every one of them. He brought them and he flattened them on the earth. And I want you to focus here because Muhammad Abdul Wahhab is not a person who's doing all of this by himself. He is doing with whose permission and who's with him on this? The leader of that people. And this is very important in our religion. This is very important. That it's not one person who sees something and he just does it. He takes matters into his own hands. The Shaykh Rahimahullah, with the permission of Uthman ibn Muammar and him, they both went and they did it. So many of those things were destroyed. Now when this had happened, news has started to spread amongst the people. People are now becoming a bit upset with the Shaykh. And they're getting a bit vicious with him. Rahimahullah. So the Hakim of Uyayna, whose name is what? Uthman ibn Nasir ibn Muammar. Muammar is now being sent letters from all over the neighboring cities. You know, and you have to remember the Arabian Peninsula, no one governs the whole country now. It's only tribal leaders. The neighboring tribe are sending letters and saying, what are you doing? What is this that we're hearing? Stop this. So Uthman ibn Nasir Muammar, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab entered on to him and he said, be patient. Allah is with those who are patient. And inshallah, the person who shows patience, the final ending is with them. So after Uthman said, okay, no problem. We'll finish off after the salah, inshallah ta'ala, with the other parts, inshallah ta'ala.